Welcome to another edition of our weekly online chemistry class. In the previous episode, we started enantiomerism, where I told you that enantiomers are compounds that can rotate in a plane of polarized light. And those compounds are called enantiomers because they have chirality property. I also informed you that the direction of rotation of a molecule in a plane of polarized light can either be dextral rotation or level rotation, as we have discussed, under optical activity. And that is dependent, the degree of rotation is also dependent on factors such as concentration of the solution as well as the path length of the sample tube. I also told you how to determine the configuration of an enantiomer using Kahn in gold trilog system of configuration determination, which can either be S or R depending on the arrangement of the substituent on the asymmetric carbon. Today we are going to conclude that topic, which is enantiomerism, and we'll start by looking at what we call optical purity. Optical purity and enantiomeric excess, i.e. enantiomeric excess. Do not forget, before we proceed, to subscribe to our YouTube channel in order to get updates on our videos whenever we upload. Optical purity. An enantiomer is optically active or it's optically pure if such stereoisomer or such enantiomer consists of one stereoisomer in the solution. For instance, 2-butanol, okay, S2-butanol, don't forget this S stands for the configuration, while the plus stands for the direction of rotation, which is dextral rotation, is a chiral molecule on the carbon 2. And that molecule has specific rotation of plus, okay, let's use 2-bromobutane, which has a specific rotation of plus 23.1 degree. This molecule, what it means is that when you place P of enantiomer of this molecule, the S enantiomer, in a plane of polarized light, the degree of rotation, the specific rotation of the molecule is plus 23.1 degree. However, when you place a sample of this molecule in a plane of polarized light, and you observe a degree of rotation, an observed specific rotation of 0 degree, that should tell you that that molecule is not optically active. And such condition is what we refer to as a racemic mixture or a racemate. So a racemate is a molecule or is a substance that is not optically active, and it is normally represented as plus and minus. That means that solution contains equal amounts of S and R enantiomer of the molecule. Meaning, if one rotates dextral in the right direction, the other one rotates in the left direction in a plane of polarized light. However, when we have an observed specific rotation of such a solution, which is positive in value and less than the actual specific rotation of the S enantiomer of 2-bromobutane, it indicates that there is presence of a racemate as well as pure form of the S or enantiomer of 2-bromobutane. Let's assume that we have an enantiomer, an observed specific rotation of 6.9 degree. This is plus 6.9 degrees. Since the value is positive, it means we have more excess of S enantiomer in the solution. And since the value is less than the actual specific rotation of S enantiomer of 2-bromobutane, it means we also have a racemate. So how do we now determine the optical purity? Optical purity of a solution is given as the observed specific rotation of the mode of solution divided by specific rotation of pure enantiomer. And for an optically pure sample, optical purity, the value is always equal to the enantiomeric excess. That means in this kind of solution, if the observed specific rotation is plus 6.9 degrees and the specific rotation of the pure enantiomer is plus 23.1 degrees, that means the optical purity will be plus 6.9 degrees divided by plus 23.1 degrees. When you divide this value, whatever you get is the purity of the sample, and that should give us something around, let's say, approximately 40%. I don't know what the value is, but when you divide, you should get something closer to that. Oh, sorry, that should give us a 0.4. So when you convert this to percentage, you have 40%. So because the value of the optical purity is less than 1 or less than 100%, it means we have a racemic mixture in the solution as well as the pure form of the enantiomer. And the excess of the enantiomer is 40%. That means 60% of the solution contains a racemate and 40% contains S-enantiomer of 2-bromobutane. So out of the 60%, 30 is S and 30% is R enantiomer. So that means the total amount of S enantiomer in that solution is 30 plus 40, 70%, while the amount of R enantiomer is 30%, because a racemate contains equal amount of both S and R of the compound, form of the compound in the solution. Let's take an instance. Assuming you have a solution containing you have 30 mil of 0.1 molar R enantiomer of a particular compound in the solution, and you have 50 mil of 0.1 molar S enantiomer of the same compound in the same solution, having a specific rotation, let's go for 2-bromobutane, having an observed specific rotation of, let's assume, 2.31 degree. Okay, so what you are going to determine is that you determine, of course, you determine the number of mole of each enantiomer in the mixture. So number of mole of R enantiomer is equal to the volume multiplied by the concentration, and that will give us 3 millimole. So number of mole of S enantiomer is the volume multiplied by the concentration, 5 millimoles. Even from this, you can observe that the number of mole of S enantiomer is higher than that of R enantiomer, and that indicates that 3 out of 5 of S combined with 3 of R to give you 3 racemates. So the number of mole of racemates in the solution is 3 millimoles. So total number of mole, N total, is equal to 3 plus 5, and that will give you 8 millimoles. So number of mole of excess S enantiomer is equal to 5 minus 3, 2 millimoles. So we can determine the optical purity, since the enantiomeric excess is 2 millimoles, to be equal to the observed specific rotation, which is a, okay, the optical purity is the excess amount of S, 2, divided by the total number of mole, 8, and that will give us 1 over 4 is 0.25. That is the optical purity, which is same thing as 25%. So this 25% is the excess of the S enantiomer in that solution, and the solution has a specific rotation of plus 2.31 degree. So that means, and do not forget that the optical purity, which is same thing as 0.25, is equal to the observed specific rotation, which is a plus 2.31 degree. Okay, assuming we don't know the specific rotation of the enantiomer, we have X. So that means the value of X is now equal to plus 2.31 degree divided by plus 23.1 degree. And of course, that will give us what? Okay, plus 0.25 degree. I mean 0.25. And that will give us 4.62 times 2, 9 9.22 plus 9.22 degrees. So this is the specific rotation of the S enantiomer in the molecule. And do not forget that out of this 25%, the 25% means 25% of the solution contains S, pure S enantiomer, while 75% of the solution contains equal both S and R enantiomer. So that means if 75% contain both R and S, so the amount of R out of the 75% will give us what? We are going to have 75 divided by 2, that will give us 35.5% S enantiomer and 35.5% R enantiomer. So the total amount of S in the solution will be 25 plus this, which will give us 60.5% S enantiomer. So this is, so if the question goes further to ask you to determine the direction of rotation of each enantiomer in the mixture, since you have gotten the the specific rotation of that solution, so that means the S configuration has a specific rotation of plus 9.22 degree, which is the value obtained here, while the R enantiomer, we have a specific rotation of minus, the same value but different sign, minus 9.22 degree. Do not forget that the plus and minus indicate the degree or direction of rotation of the molecule, which are dextrorotatory as well as levorotatory respectively. So that's how to relate the optical purity, which is same thing as enantiomeric excess, to determine the observed specific rotation of a stereoisomer as well as the amount of each enantiomer present in the solution. Now, I want us to look at a situation whereby you are given an enantiomer containing more than one chiral center. So enantiomers containing more than one chiral center, the number of stereoisomers that will be obtained cannot be an enantiomer that has four chiral centers. So the number of possible stereoisomers is equal to 2 raised to the power 4, which will give us 16. So that means you are going to have a possible of 16 stereoisomers. So let's take an example by looking at 3-bromo, 2-butanol. Using Fischer projection formula, let's look at the possible stereoisomers that could be obtained from this molecule. And don't forget that carbon 2 of that compound is a chiral carbon because it is asymmetric in nature, surrounded by a bromo atom, a hydrogen atom, an hydroxy group, a methyl group, as well as an ethyl group. So we have two chiral centers. The first chiral center is on carbon 1, where you have carbon 2 rather. On carbon 2, you have hydroxy group, you have hydrogen. On carbon 3, you have a bromo group, hydrogen. So these are the two chiral centers, then a methyl group. Now, don't forget, I told you in the previous edition how to determine the configuration of a molecule. So you have to determine the configuration of this carbon 2 and configuration of this carbon 3. If you want to do that, the configuration of carbon 2, this is the most rank of the highest priority because oxygen has the highest atomic number. So if you rank this as substituent 1, then substituent 2 will be the whole of this group because this carbon, this is carbon. On this carbon is hydrogen, but you have a bromine atom here. So this is rank 2, this is rank 3, and this is rank 4. From 1 to 2, the direction of rotation, the configuration of the molecule is anti-clockwise, which is S. But because hydrogen is located horizontal in the Fischer projection formula, so that means the configuration will be the opposite of what you have, which is 2R. Now, for the chiral center 3, you have bromo having the highest priority, followed by the whole of this group, followed by this and this. So that means the configuration from 1 to 2 is clockwise. So since hydrogen is still placed horizontally, so the direction of the configuration is 3S, which I've explained in the previous episode. So the stereoisomer of this is this. Okay? You have hydrogen, OH, bromo, CH3. Okay? You can have another stereoisomer of that molecule. And in that case, you have something of this nature. OH, hydrogen, hydrogen, bromo, CH3, CH3. And lastly, you have another stereoisomer, hydrogen, OH, hydrogen, bromo, CH3, and CH3. Now, looking at this, we have four stereoisomers. You can determine the configuration of each chiral center. One, two, three, and four. Now, you will observe that two is the stereoisomer or the enantiomer to one. So that means one and two are enantiomers. Because if you place one in a plane of polarized light, you are going to get two. But if you place one or two in a plane of polarized light, you can't get three or four because of the arrangement of the groups that are attached to the chiral centers. So one and two are enantiomers. Likewise, three and four are also enantiomers. But based on the arrangement, the type of enantiomerism that exists between one and two is what we call erythroenantiomerism. So one and two are erythroenantiomers, while three and four are trioenantiomers. Trio, T-H-R-E-O. Why? Because when you have two enantiomers and two similar groups are placed in the same direction, like here, hydrogen, hydrogen on the same side, hydrogen, hydrogen on the same side, they are called erythroenantiomers. But when two similar groups are adjacent, that is on either side of both chiral centers, we call them the trioenantiomers. However, although I told you that one and three are not enantiomers, likewise two and three or two and four. So in that case, compounds or stereoisomers, one and three, as well as two and four, are not enantiomers. We refer to them as diastereomers. Diastereomers. So diastereomers are optically active molecules that are not mirror images of each other. They are optically active, they contain chiral centers, they contain a symmetric carbon atom, but they are not mirror images of each other. Meaning, if you place one in a plane of polarized light, you cannot get the other one, although both are optically active. And unlike enantiomers, which have the same physical properties and similar chemical properties, diastereomers usually have different physical properties and different chemical properties and are easy to isolate in solutions. So that's that. Now, meanwhile, the number of chiral centers in a molecule. I told you that the maximum number of stereoisomers that we obtain is 2 raised to the power n. But you can get less than that. And I want us to look at a situation where you have butan 2,3 dihol. Let's look at that. Butan 2,3 dihol. Let us draw the structure of that molecule. Butan 2,3 dihol has two chiral centers, just like 3-bromo, butan 2-O. But the chiral center, as I said earlier, are on carbon atoms 2 and 3. So you have, instead of OH here, you have OH here. I mean, instead of hydrogen here, okay, let me put hydrogen here, and I put OH here, then you have CH3. So these are still the chiral center, butan 2,3 dihol. If you place this in a plane of polarized light, you are going to observe a stereoisomer, which is a hydrogen, OH, OH, hydrogen, CH3, CH3. And the third stereoisomer that you are likely to get or to obtain is this, where you have OH, OH, hydrogen, hydrogen, CH3, and CH3. The fourth one is the mirror image of this, but it will not show because the mirror image of this one and itself are the same. And you are going to see why they are the same. So this and this are enantiomers, and they are trioenantiomers. because they are mirror images of each other. Why this and this, or this and this are diastereomers? However, if you look at this stereoisomer, you will observe that there is a line of symmetry, meaning you can divide it into two equal halves. And both halves may have different direction of rotation. So molecules or stereoisomers that have line of symmetry that are not optically active are what we refer to as mesocompound or mesoforms. Why? If you determine the configuration of this, this is 1, 2, so that is S, meaning this, if this is carbon 2, it will be 2R because of the position of this. If you determine the configuration of this, 1, 2, so that is R, so that means it will be 3S. So meaning in the same compound, you have two different configuration. And that means if this rotates clockwise, this will rotate at the clockwise ring in a plane of polarized light. So because there is a line of symmetry, the optical activity of the molecule will cancel out. And such molecule will not be optically active. Although mesocompounds contain chiral carbons or stereogenic centers, but they are not optically active. Meaning, if you allow the molecule to a plane of polarized light, if you place the molecule in a plane of polarized light, there won't be any direction of rotation. So such molecules are called mesocompounds. Although you are expecting four stereoisomers, the compounds that have mesoform usually are one less than the number of stereoisomers that is obtainable using the formula 2^n. So with this, we have come to the end of our enantiomerism, and I believe you have learned a lot concerning enantiomerism, which is an important configurational type of isomerism that we have. So in the subsequent edition, we are going to another aspect of chemistry entirely. And this aspect of chemistry, we are probably going to be discussing inorganic chemistry or general chemistry. Thanks for watching. See you again next time.